and well-being of many seniors and families living in San Francisco. And we're seeing that this phenomenon is not just restricted to San Francisco, but it's moving to other parts of the Bay Area, moving to Southern California, and places even beyond that. Earlier this year, 88-year-old Elaine Turner, who was a 30-year resident of North Beach, died. She was served an Ellis Act eviction from a landlord who, ironically, is a researcher as part of something called the 90-plus study out of UC Irvine, which is funded in part by the National Institute on Aging. Elaine did not know where she was going to go, did not know what was going to happen to her in a market, a real estate market, whose median price right now is more than $4,000. It causes much terror in the minds and in the hearts of seniors who don't know where they're going to end up. Another tenant and senior who was evicted by way of the Ellis Act was a gentleman by the name of Ron Lickard. Ron was a Native American. He was part of the 1968 takeover of Alcatraz, and he was one of the folks that held this city in high esteem, particularly the crisis at the International Hotel, something that was close to his heart. He was Ellis Act evicted, and the buyout, the payout that they gave him was not enough to sustain him and his family for a length of time. He passed away several months ago. So we're gathered here to remember Elaine Turner and Ron Lickers. This is round two of the DA visit that started a few months ago, where Poor Magazine and gathered tenants who had been evicted to file a complaint with the DA's office. The DA's office has not responded to our concerns, even though we have sent emails and we have made calls. That being said, I would like to call on Tiny, a.k.a. Lisa Gray Garcia, who is the co-editor of Poor Magazine, who will lead us in prayer for the elders and families who have been victims to all of this, and give us more information on the Ellis Act and evictions for profit and why this is elder abuse. Again, Tiny from Poor Magazine.
Stolen indigenous territory. First Nations, Ohlone people are the ones who suffered the first form of colonization. Behind the lives of missionaries like Kunipara Seto just got canonized for being a murderer and stealing ancestral territory and a language and traditions. So first of all, we need to recognize that that form of colonization and that historical trauma and eviction is actually very similar to what we're experiencing today. This part of Turtle Island has been here before. Today we're talking about the genocide of displacement, the genocide of eviction. And if you're an elder, or if you're a mother or a father, and you get evicted and you end up on the street, which is what you do in this town, because there is no other housing. There is no affordable housing, there is no poor people housing, and the only thing there is very rich people housing in this stolen city that has been bought and paid for by politicians like Ed Lai.
Yes, Ed
Lai. So, we first of all have to honor our elders right now and our children. I'm standing next to my son, who, when he and I were evicted from Mama House in the Mission, because they wanted to charge $5,000 a month for a place that was worth $800, maybe, we ended up homeless. We didn't end up okay. We ended up homeless. So I'd like us all to take a moment of silence for Ohlone First Nations people. This is Yalamu territory, as well as Elaine Turner, Ashe, as well as Ron Lickers, Ashe Aho, as well as all the elders and children who are now houseless because of this displacement and this gentrification.
Wait a minute.
I'm gonna put Tony back on, but I want to just tell people that this district attorney is protecting the rich and the powerful and the ruling class. That's why he didn't call us back. That's why she didn't call us back. And they think that we're just going to go away. Well, guess what? Us poor people aren't ever going away. We might be evicted, but we'll just keep staying here and we'll keep it on.
In the past, I guess the past couple of years, something called low-fault to no-fault evictions have been on the rise more than 80%. Supervisor Kim introduced legislation that passed recently called Eviction Protections 2.0 that would allow tenants to remedy low-fault to no-fault evictions, these frivolous evictions that landlords are using simply to get people out of the rent-controlled housing in order to re-rent at a higher rate. There was an article that came out in this morning's Examiner that says that Mayor Lee is considering vetoing that legislation that folks advocated for and worked very hard for. Now, mind you, the 2.0 legislation is needed, and we're glad that it passed. But it's not earth-shattering stuff, okay? And clearly, Mayor Lee is the mayor of the rich, of speculators. He's the mayor of real estate agents. He's the mayor of tech. And for the rest of us, he does not give a damn. That's why we're here, because seniors have been proportionately taken advantage of in this eviction crisis. There's been health and psychological damage that's been done to seniors that must be addressed if San Francisco is going to continue to claim to be a progressive city that gives a damn about its residents and who claims to want to have a policy called aging in place. That being said, I would like to call up a tenant who was evicted, I believe, back in 2008 at the start of the eviction crisis by way of the Ellis Act. Marty Susannis has been living in San Francisco a long time. She was on the front line for the fight for the International Hotel against that eviction in 1977. And we would like, and her fight continues. It has not ended. And I would like to welcome Ms. Marty Susannis. Marty?
Really upset right now, so I almost didn't make it here, but I am here, and I was Ellis Act evicted in 2007 from my home of 21 years, and I was in a rent-controlled home, and I worked out of my home. It's my business and my home. And I was so devastated at the time. I was 65 years old. I'm 72 now. That I got breast cancer in the middle of the move. And frankly, I didn't even care because losing my home was more upsetting to me than getting the breast cancer. And that's really the truth. So now the rents had gone up. And I could not find anything that was affordable when I moved out. And if I had to leave the city, I would lose my business, all of my income, because at 65, I had to continue working because my Social Security at the time was about 500 and something. Now it's 618 a month. There's no way you can live on that in this town. And I just had a guardian angel on my side at the time that I moved out, and I went and looked at this house, and I got a landlord that was decent at the time, and he actually lowered the rent for me because he wanted a really wonderful tenant like myself. And I moved in, and I've been there 8 years, but unfortunately, I'm in a condo, and the market rate for that condo building has increased up to $4,500. And there's no way I can do this. And so I struggled getting job upon job. And as a writer, right now I'm not making a lot of money, but I'm creative and I've been able to survive this barely. But now he raised the rent last year to $600 more per month, because when I asked to meet with him, he was nice enough to come over and we talked. And he said, okay. I said, I can't afford this. This is what I make. I showed him my Social Security statement. Very polite meeting, because that's the only way I can talk to the landlord. And he said, what do you want me to do? You want me to lower the rent? And I said, if you can, it would really be helpful. And so then he said, okay, how much? And I was so staggered, I didn't know what to say. Well, he lowered it by about $300 more. And I said, could I please have this in writing? And he said, oh, no, honey, we don't. He says, I trust you. I thought, well, you know, I don't trust you. You know, I didn't say that. But I thought, you got to be kidding me. And so he said, no, we'll just do that. We'll just lower it. 2 weeks later, I get a phone call, and he said, I'm so sorry, but I've talked to, you know, I refinanced my home, and I have to raise it up to $3,000 again. And he said, anyway, that was last year. And he said, don't worry, I've thought it through. I've got a solution. I know you don't have the money. We'll take it out of your security deposit. Now, I haven't told people any of this because it seems ridiculous. But, so I said, but then I won't have a security deposit when I move out. And he said, well, we'll worry about that then. Well, the next month, I went back to just paying the normal rate because I didn't want this deducted from my security deposit. So now, last year, as I said, he raised it to $600, and that's how it's been. And, of course, my Social Security is $618, and I have to keep working. And I can't keep up with the market rate. And the stress for me has gone back from 2008. It has not stopped. And that is the truth, because I'm seeing what's going on around the city. It's terrifying for everybody, you know. But now the stress is really getting to me again, because I know that in October, the end of October, I'm going to get another rent increase, a rate increase. And I honestly am staggered, because I have no comprehension on what to do, because, as I said, I have a business, a small pet sitting business. I have freelance writing jobs around the town. If I leave San Francisco, I'm losing all of my income except the $618. And I want to know, where in this country can I go to live for $618 at age 72? If someone can tell me where the heck I can go, please step up. Because this is just really unconscionable what's happening. It's immoral. It's undemocratic, it's not Christian. I could go on and on with my adjectives, but, I mean, I think people know what's going on. And I said in a documentary film that I was in recently, I said, you know, my health is starting to fail, and it really is, again. And I said in the film that I'm defending my home, and what I mean by home is not the home I'm in, but my home of San Francisco, which has been my community, my home, my work. All of my writing was done in San Francisco. You know, I used to write for major magazines. I've been here over 50 years, and I'm so angry that I said in the film, I will fight until I can't fight anymore. And
That's why we're doing this today. Marty Susanis is one of the claimants on the case. Okay. So I know that we have a conscious lawyer here today, and I just want to say that, sadly, most lawyers actually are liars. I'm just going to say it. As a poor person who dealt with public pretenders and all of those things most of our lives, we're not joking when we say that, but... we have a comrade who actually takes his legal privilege and actually uses it for revolution and for people. So we'd like to call up Anthony Prince.
And good to see everybody here again. Let me say, first of all, that I was part of the delegation last year, I believe it was, when we sat down. We did two things. One, we forced our way in from the standpoint that we were told by the assistant district attorney that we could not file a criminal complaint. There were many of you right here are the complainants charging elder abuse by way of the Ellis Act convictions. We were told that we have to go through local police, but we knew better, and we told them that's not true. The district attorney can undertake its own independent investigation and file its own charges against perpetrators of elder abuse. In fact, some jurisdictions have what they call a vertical prosecution, where the DA, not the police, but the DA takes the case from the beginning of investigation, arrest, all the way through trial. I don't know if San Francisco district attorney has such a vertical prosecution unit for elder abuse, but they ought to create one if they don't. We met with them. They refused to talk to us at that time, but then they said, we'll meet with you 1 week from now. We sat down with them, and right off the bat, Assistant District Attorney Wong said, well, look, it's perfectly legal to carry out these Ellis Act convictions. You're asking us to prosecute landlords who are simply doing something that they're entitled to do under the law. And I said to her, I said, listen, it never occurred to me that the job of the district attorney is to contemplate the defense to a criminal charge and therefore make a decision not to bring the charge. I mean, is that not true? There are people walking in and out of this courthouse all day long, charges stacked up. The DA has multiple charges. And do they think about the defense that could be offered? Sure they do. But they prosecute these cases in any event. So I would say, first of all, that I question the legitimacy of making a decision not to investigate, charge, and prosecute violators of the Ellis Act. I'm sorry, violators of the Elder Abuse Act, simply because they're acting under the cover of another law, the Ellis Act. Now, the other thing I want to say is that, for those who don't know, in 1941, there was a very famous Supreme Court decision here in California called Edwards versus California. How many people, Connie was talking about the Ohlone, Connie was talking about the original people, and everyone here is talking about poor people being kicked out of San Francisco by way of the Ellis Act and other mechanisms. But did you know that during the Depression, the state of California passed a law that made it a criminal offense to bring a poor person into the state of California? That law was in effect for the entire duration of the Depression and was only overturned in 1941, not by the California Supreme Court, but by the United States Supreme Court. It stood up and said, you can't do this. You can't make a criminal offense the act of bringing a poor person to California. Now, here we are in 2015, and it seems like they're once again making it a criminal offense to be poor in the state of California. Am I right about that?
Yeah.
That's why we're out here today. And if they think we're going to go away, they got another thing coming, because we're going to get together and we're going to put our heads together. And I have to tell you that this is one of the most creative approaches I've ever seen. It was not an attorney who came up with the idea of going after these Ellis Act landlords based on their violations of the elder abuse statute. That idea came up from Tiny and you guys. And I think that that's an inspiration. And now it becomes, that's right, you guys are the ones that came up with that theory. You guys. The people came up with that theory, and the lawyers should do the righteous lawyers should do the bidding of the people, and I think that's a viable legal theory. Now, let me point out one more thing, and then I'll stop. There's a lot of ways we can go at this thing, and we're going to talk about them. There's such a thing as the RICO Act. California has its own RICO Act, Racketeer Influence and Corrupt Organization. We need to look at these apartment owner organizations. We need to look at these various condominium operators associations, these realtors, and their various business groupings, and see if in fact what they're really doing is engaging in racketeering and corrupt practices. At least the district attorney should investigate before it declares, well, that's not something we can do. And I'll tell you one more thing. You cannot hide criminal conduct behind a certain right that you may have according to civil law. You cannot do that. If I operate a shoe factory and I say, well, look, I'm only trying to make shoes, I'm only trying to make a profit here, it's not my intention to hurt anybody, so leave me alone. Well, so someone dies on that shoe factory, they could be criminally prosecuted for homicide.
Right.
You know that? And they can't hide behind the fact that they have a legal right to run that factory, to operate that factory. Well, I say that these rapacious landlords and these developers have no right to hide behind the Ellis Act in order to get away with essentially, I don't want to say the M word, but essentially, people are dying. And they can't hide behind the this statute. So we've got some other ideas. We have some other legal principles we're going to throw into the mix. The concept of substantial certainty. You don't have to necessarily have the specific intent to hurt someone or kill someone. But if you act in reckless disregard, if you act completely unmindful, you act in such a manner as it is substantially certain, it's a high probability that someone could be hurt or killed, you may be liable for a criminal offense. You see what I'm saying? So there's some creativity we need here. There's some solid law. And most importantly, there's the organization of the people themselves. So the law of Anthony P. Prince is right here. They're going to stay right here, part of this fight. Thanks so much.
We're just going to have two last speakers. I'm going to call the youth scholars up because we have young scholars from Poor Magazine and Decolonized Academy who are actually themselves have dealt with houselessness and struggle. So Tivo and Tyree and Timo, please come up and make your statements. This is a multi-generational fight. If we're not talking with our young people and making them understand their future liberation, we're not doing anything. So let's call up Tyree.
Okay, my name is Tyree Taylor, and I go to Decolonized Academy in Oakland. Okay, and I have a statement to say how I feel about it. How I feel about the elders getting abused by landlords, and that is why... How I feel about the elders getting abused by landlords is that it is bad and that it is not right. The landlords and the real estate agents are protected by lawyers and money. That's the reason why they never go to jail.
I'm Divorce Garcia, and I'm going to Decolonized Academy. And at Decolonized Academy, we have something called research, not research, because research is something that we do, not something that somebody else finds out about us. It's what we find out about ourselves. So, Decolonized Academy, we have research, and
do a lot of things. I've had to move back to Oakland, stay there, go back here, be in a shelter, to just wait 4 years just for a public house to have been punished point. So think about when someone gets evicted is when people do get evicted, it feels you feel you're in shock. You don't know what to do. You don't know what place to go. And you feel a lot of trauma from it because if you've been there a long time, you can really feel that way where, like, something has been taken from you, like a person has been taken from you. And a lot of things happen to people, and those two people we were talking about died because they were evicted. Not because of just natural causes and stuff, no, because they went homeless. They had to go on the streets. They didn't know where to go because of the stress, because of the pain. It doesn't go away. It does stay there. It just doesn't. It happens really quickly. When you get an eviction notice, it's there. And what I've noticed over the past time is that when getting evicted, not good at all. But if you notice, when we were evicted, I wouldn't be the person I was today. I really wouldn't. Tanya wouldn't be the person she was today. Steve wouldn't be the person she was today. No one would. We all have a story, and but I remember a quote. I don't remember who it was from. Our pain is like our art, and the art is like our pain.
Oh.
So, yeah.
You started Decolonized Academy! Two more speakers, actually. First, I want to hear from my fellow welfare queen and a powerful poet and a reporter with Poor News Network, Sister Queen Nandi.
Hey, peace and greetings to y'all people. I would say, excuse me, how y'all doing? But ain't nobody doing all right. I'm not doing all right. because it's sad. We got to fight for basic human needs and fight for human rights. What I want to say, being a third generation here, born and raised in the Western Addition, eviction not only messes with the elders, and it makes them sick, and they have died out on the street, and it has been proven, and we have worked with elders who eventually transitioned on from hell to going to heaven, and they were out in the street. And now I just want to talk about the elders. I want to talk about the children. There's a child right now. I'm going to call him Little T. He's from the Western Addition right now. And let me tell you what the displacement and eviction did to this child. It put him through a hardship and a separated family, because now that they ain't got no place to stay, him and his mom and his brother sometimes got to go couch surfing on different places and different apartments with families and friends. And I had seen this kid one time. He was stressed out at 12 o'clock midnight because whoever he was couch surfing with, they said he couldn't stay the night, and this child had to go to school the next day. So that put that poor baby in his mind and soul a stressful situation. Somebody bullied on him at school, and then he got into a fight. Now he's in juvenile. So that's one of the stories that I want to touch on. What this does is it messes up our family. It destroys. This is a deliberate destruction of the family. It's a deliberate destruction of the indigenous people who were here before y'all bastards was even thought of. The ones here, we were taking care of ourselves, and we were damn sure taking care of our elders. We got folks right now in Brooklyn, New York, taking care of a 115-year-old woman of color, a black lady out there. She's still ticking. And right now in Sicily, I think she's 112 years old. The village takes care of her. The doctor goes by and checks on her, and the people bring her food. Because, see, that's what we're obligated to do. And, see, what's wrong with the society is that I say the society is very demonic, because they want us to go against everything that God and Mother Nature said that we're obligated to do. We obligated to take care of our elders. We obligated to take care of our children. We obligated to take care of that stray dog that's on the street, and that dog is hungry. You got an obligation to take care of that dog. I don't care about your Starbucks coffee. I don't care about your tech job with your $250,000 a year goddamn job, but you got your condo by putting an elder out on the street, and that elder met his or her demise that way. So I don't care what bag you say you in, you are contributing to the destruction of the universe by not standing up in line for these things to happen. And I don't care how much money I had in my pocket. If I'm a millionaire, I'm going to be a millionaire tomorrow. I'm not going to come to nobody's neighborhood and say, well, that elder got to go because I need this place to be converted to a condo so I can stay here with my rich, worthless ass. What about the people who were there that worked hard, been in their houses 30, 40, 50, even 60 years? I know a lady right now, she's at Friendship Village, been there since, 1929, paying $250 a month in her rent. Since that time, now the new landlords came and they raised their rent to $3,000. And see, not only is should be illegal, and it is racist, because what people of color do you know can afford $3,000 a month? And then they're taking all the public housing and they're privatizing that, and then they're sticking us with these criminalizations that if my visitor in my public housing get into a fire at a barbecue, me and my family got to get out. See, so it's a setup from the get-up. Because they throw us out in the street, then they make laws against being out on the street. So what place is it for us? Jail. That's all it is. And just like they say, okay, a mother has the right to be a mother, a father has the right to be a father, we have the right to be and exist. But it is illegal for us, even if we're parents, even if we're mothers and fathers and granddaughters and grandmothers and grandsons, it'll still be illegal for us to beat our child. It'll be illegal for us to abuse our elders. So what makes you think you above the law? Illegal is illegal. It don't matter what status you come from. See, all that stolen and that false sense of superiority that you guys incorporate with this to make it seem like you're above the law. So what? Of course it's legal to be a landlord, but it's illegal to commit murder no matter how you did it. If you contribute to it, you're a goddamn accessory. Plain and simple. And by the DA and nobody else is doing nothing about it, all the folks and the children who are out here being killed, misplaced, displaced, and the elders are dying, all their blood is on your hands. Remember, it's somebody higher than all of us. We just the representatives of God and Mother Nature. But when they come down on y'all, ain't nothing gonna stop it. And then one thing I want to say, too, is one day you better hope and pray that this don't happen to your grandmother or your grandfather or your great-grandmother, your great-grandfather. Because when I look back in history, my story, our story, when so-and-so's white folks thought that, oh, my God, we're going to lose our houses because the slaves have been free. Now, they want everything. Y'all fuckers legalized guns. So that's what y'all did when y'all was faced with the so-called gentrification, thinking y'all was going to lose the land that y'all stole. Y'all start arming yourselves up. But then y'all want to take these rights away from all the other people around the world who you refuse to share this universe with because this universe don't belong to you. It doesn't. You are a thief. You are a liar. You are a land stealer. We have the Pena family that's out in the Mission District that stood up and helped pave the way for colonizers and gentrifiers to come into the goddamn Mission, and then they got kicked out and they got stage 4 cancer. So that is murder. Straight up, no matter how you slice it, that is murder. And if you throw a child out on the street, that is elder abuse. Y'all want to take our children from us for disciplining them, but it's okay for y'all to shoot them and make them houseless. Get your story straight, because that's what's dooming our world. That's what's dooming our country. The wickedness and the hypocrisy. And you know you better get yourself right. And you know you better repent, because it ain't going to get no better. All these things that you see on the news, all these bad things that are happening, everything you put into the universe, you're going to get back tenfold. So you better stop and think about what you're doing. You better stop and think about what you're doing to somebody's grandmother. Love to her grandmother like you love your own grandmother. Because that's the only way we're going to repair this, is for you to repent and stop with the wealth hoarding, and then the DA, y'all do what y'all need to do, because there are families out here being killed, and there's families that are being separated and incarcerated, and it should be, it's against the law, it's against the law of the universe for you to deny anybody their right to housing, equality, employment, healthy food. It's all a right that God gave us, and no man alive has the right to take that from us. So y'all keep on fighting, because when God and Mother Nature is for us, who gonna be against us? Y'all better repent right damn now.
Our last speaker of today is going to be the wife of Ron Lickers, and I think we could bring this over so she doesn't have to stand. So it's
we were evicted in, we were served with an eviction about 2009, but because we were both disabled, we had to give an extension, and we also were paid to have to go home, but we've been here for 26 years. Our daughter was born there. She goes to school in San Francisco. I'm a school employee, so we didn't have enough money to actually relocate and work for 2 years in the city. Couldn't find any housing that was affordable for us. We've been on the list for housing for many years and were never called for a place to live. So after 28 years, we had to leave our home. The only home that my daughter knows. And now she's without her father. She's 17 and she's trying to apply for college and live her life and go through milestones. So hard for her. And so he won't be there for Thanksgiving or Christmas or her graduation or taking her off to college. She's gone. We both became really ill through this eviction. We were there 28 years. Our landlord passed away, and some guy comes from the Netherlands, bought the building, and kicked everybody out. He didn't care. He tore out all the rugs above our heads because he moved into the building after evicting everybody else out. We were the last ones left. And he allowed his son to play basketball on top of our heads. He had animals that ran through the apartment all night. We were clearly harassed. Ron called the police many times, and they said that there was really nothing we can do. We got a lawyer from her name was Fox. I can't remember her first name, but she's with an agency to try to protect these kinds of evictions. But it still goes on. And I'm so sorry to see all of you who are affected by this and have to go through this also like we did. We couldn't find a place. We had to move to Daly City, but my daughter goes to school here, so it's been a hardship on all of us. But the worst part is having to lose a really good man, Native American. I'm a third generation San Franciscan, and now I can't even be in my own city. And I too am Native. I'm Mono and Mission. My grandfather owned a home in Potrero, and he lost that. And then we've all been displaced ever since then. But I pray for all of you that you don't have to suffer the way my daughter has to.
We just have a round of applause for our survivors. I mean, here we are still fighting by any means. You feel me? I just also want to call out the fact that these so-called real estate snakes and devil ropers, as we call them at Poor Magazine, aka mostly rich, all rich people, mostly white folks, walk the streets all the time committing these capital crimes against people and never get convicted because they're hiding behind bloodstained dollars and rich lawyers who protect every move they make. And yet, when us poor people jaywalk, walk while black or brown, drive while black, brown, or poor, we are evicted, we are convicted, we are tested, and we are arrested. And then we are incarcerated in places like this. There is a price on our head to constantly be criminalized, as my sister Nandi pointed out, and we're fighting tomorrow. As the author of the quote-unquote stop and frisk and the broken window theory, he's coming to town and happily popping his collar about, hey, I figured out a way to clean the streets of poor people and people of color all across this stolen indigenous Turtle Island. So, yeah, we're going to be doing a little research release tomorrow as well. You should join us at the Marriott Hotel, 780 Mission Street, at 12 p.m. Maybe Mr. Kelling will learn a thing or two. Last speaker is Uncle Bruce Allison Bobby Scholar.
Not only they're evicting, these people got money coming out of their ass. And they are giving away free schools to anybody who wants to learn how to evict the people. I get constantly on my email about 20 of them. And this tells how to get around the law, how to do everything, and everything else. Every time I show up, I get thrown out or either arrested. Thank you very much.
All right. Okay, everybody, we're going to go in and, get our appointment with the district attorney right now. By any means necessary.
Oh, thank you. Appreciate it. Hi, everyone. So, based on what I heard, based on my understanding, it sounded like there is a petition or something that you had that you wanted to pass along. I also heard that there was apparently a press conference outside, so however I can be of service, I'm here to help, whatever you guys would like to pass along.
My name is Anthony.
How are you doing?
What is your name?
Alex Beston. I'm also an attorney. I'm a prosecutor here at the DA's office.
Okay. Here you go. Here's my business card. Okay. Well, what is it you guys are seeing?
So, I'm interested in the fact that you're acting like this is the first time. In May of this year, we went here and filed three claims for elder abuse under Code 368 against Landlords, which is a follow-up to what we've done in 2014.
Okay.
And we got a date stamp. One of our claimants is here, and another claimant, too, lost a person's post-mortem. So anyway, the point is that we never got even so much as an email back.
So I'm not certain why that's happening, and the reason I say that is because I heard that you all had a press conference and a date set with the district attorney, and nobody actually reached out to our office about that, as far as I know. So what I would suggest is let me give you my business card and reach out to me directly, because I don't know.
Well, we're here now, so we'd like to sit down with you now.
You can sit down with me. I mean, feel free to take a seat. I'll bring a chair for you if you like. It's no problem.
That's not the point.
Oh, no, I'm telling you, I'm more than happy to sit down with you right now.
Great.
But again, I don't know anything about this paper per se.
And there's a person named Sharon Will who works here, right?
Yes, there is.
So that's who we were given the card of last time. Uh-huh. That's who the emails were sent to.
So
and not once again did we get a call back.
I completely understand. And my understanding is you sat down with her based on what you're telling me right now.
Uh-huh.
So you sat with her and you had a discussion with her.
So there were two different files. The first one was in 2014, and she sat down with us at that time and said that we needed to bring in more evidence.
Got it. Did you bring anything back?
Yeah. Well, three claimants came in May and actually physically themselves as evidentiary of the people who have suffered the abuse, one of whom is here today.
How are you?
Right. And so this is, what more evidence do you need?
I completely understand what you're
saying.
So we actually have prosecuted landlords before. I don't know if you guys have read the news about the landlords from hell, for example. It was a national story. I'm just trying to inform you all of the totality of everything, right? So there are certain penal code sections applicable that give us avenues to prosecute a case. So again, I don't know the particulars of this exact case or of these particular cases that you speak of. I only know what I know. And I don't have knowledge of this, unfortunately. I literally was in the back room. I was told that there are people out here, so I'm here to sit down and talk to all of you on a humanistic level, right?
Okay.
But that being said, we do prosecute landlords, and we have prosecuted landlords. All you have to do is Google it at the end of the day. And you can Google landlords from hell, and you can see it for yourself. Some of the egregious acts that these landlords did really got them caught up in state prison. But the trick and the secret and the thing that everything that we do here at the office really entails is evidence. There has to be evidence in order for us to prosecute someone under a penal code section. So, again, without being fully versed on the complaints, if a landlord, let's say, is doing something that's civil in nature, there are civil remedies that can be obtained. As an attorney, I'm guessing you do landlord-tenant? Okay, so as you know, there are civil remedies there under landlord-tenant, but when there are penal code sections that are violated, then there are avenues by which an office such as ours can really find a way to pursue a case criminally. So that's really the thing. I'm not certain what the papers that you provided in the testimony or the evidence that you provided, Sharon, is, but if it was penal in nature, criminal in nature versus civil in nature, I think that's something that perhaps we're not, getting to the forefront of the discussion. That's elder abuse, right? But what is the basis for the 368? Was there a physical strike? Was there embezzlement? Was there someone going into different someone's pocket? Was there something like that? Or?
Well, the basic idea, and what you're telling us, your gentleman, when we sat down on that last year,
what's the difference?
She basically said, essentially, because the chief allegation here is that these people have been the claimants have been, were evicted pursuant to the Ellis Act.
Oh, is this the Ellis, is this Ellis Act? Is this based on Ellis Act? That is, okay, I didn't know that. I thought maybe someone was going to,
sure, please hold on.
Sure.
So, and all this information was provided to Ms. Wu, and our view of the cases. She came back and said, I don't know what you were about to say, but just let me tell you.
No problem.
What she told us was that that was a defense, and that and because they had a legal right to evict people, she more or less, and those of you who were there, correct me if I'm wrong, indicated that you guys could not take the case, you could not investigate it or prosecute it, because this was an Ellis Act. They had a legitimate right to pull out of the rental business. And so there's nothing she could do. She actually sat there and more or less indicated there was nothing she could do. So perhaps that's why we haven't gotten any return phone calls. She did say, as Ms. Garcia said, she did indicate that if you have evidence. And then the next day after our meeting, actually, with the, I don't know if that meeting, but after the press conference, Mr. Stone, your boss, said publicly in the newspapers that if we had evidence, directly addressing the question of whether we can show evidence that the Ellis Act eviction was in either simultaneously or led to an elderly violation, that he would look into it.
Okay.
All right. So that promise has been broken. I'm glad to hear you say that you're now going to reassume, you know, the responsibility of this attorney's office and make a careful investigation of the evidence.
That's not exactly what I said.
Okay.
Well, okay. I'm here.
You're not going to do that then?
No. That's again.
We don't know
what I said. What I suspect is happening is there's a little bit of miscommunication, and the miscommunication is on two fronts. When you first came, nobody said Ellis Act, first of all. I was under the impression that there was some kind of elder abuse as it relates to physical or financial abuse in some capacity that occurred other than an Ellis Act situation. Now, with the Ellis Act situation, that is a completely different problem we encounter, which perhaps, again, you might have understood or discussed this in detail before. There's a preemption issue. Are you guys familiar with the concept and the doctrine of preemption?
Yeah.
So preemption is one of those situations where we are preempted from taking certain remedies dependent on the evidence, dependent on the statutes in place. So if there's a state statute in place or if there's a federal statute in place, it can preempt us from taking certain actions. But that being said, that doesn't necessarily mean that based on the facts and circumstances, there aren't other evidentiary avenues to, for example, prosecute a case under 368, dependent on the evidence, right? So if there's anything additional that you haven't provided, Sharon, I'm more than happy to take it. I'm more than happy to review it. And I would like you or whoever is the person who's representing everybody to contact me directly. I would really much, very much appreciate that, because I don't want you to be calling the direct number that is maybe an automated system. I want you to call me directly.
Okay, well, let's see if we can pin down an agreement for the record.
Mm-hmm.
So, and what I'm getting is that you are willing to look at evidence, the evidence we have that would show that there have been violations of the Elder Abuse Act by way of landlords, purchases of buildings and rental properties by way of their evicting their tenants under the Ellis Act. I'm sure you're familiar, it's not the first time that criminal activity has been couched within or has been attempted to shield criminal activity by way of something which is legally permissible. I'm sure you're familiar with that. We believe that's what's happening here, and there has been physical injury. The harm that's been inflicted has been all the way from death to assault, battery on the street. We believe that these landlords, the parties that are utilizing health extension, either know or should know, there's a high probability and perhaps a substantial certainty that when they put these people out, that they will face physical violence in the street and possibly even death. So we think that this is it absolutely falls within the parameters of the district attorney's office to prosecute cases of elder abuse. I was a little bit distressed to hear Ms. Wu say, well, this is what the Ellis Act calls for. And in my experience, the district attorney's office doesn't make a charging decision or an investigatory decision based on a contemplated defense. Let the landlords raise the Ellis Act as a defense. I believe it's the district attorney's job to investigate allegations of crime and to talk to witnesses and create a safe environment for the witnesses. So we've been put off a number of times, all the way from when we first came here, and
citizen, but she also arranged to meet with us the following week.
So I don't mean to cut you off or be any disrespectful in any
way. Well, you said we could talk, so go ahead.
I've just been listening for a few minutes now.
But,
and all right, publicly
don't
want to say.
I want to make something for the record, though. Mm-hmm. You're agreeing, just so let me finish this point.
Mm-hmm.
I would suggest that instead of time,
I'm agreeing to be the point of contact. I'm agreeing that you, since you sound like you're talking on behalf of everyone, whoever is the person that's talking on behalf of everyone, I would like you to contact me directly. Email is the best. Okay?
Right.
Send me an email.
Let's set up a meeting right now. What we'd like to, I think the best, most expeditious way to do it.
I think the best thing to do is to send me an email and then we can fix
it. Well, I don't think that is.
No,
because we've been sending emails, sir, and got nothing. The minute we leave here, the minute the media walks out of here, you guys close the book and see you later. Sorry, sucker.
Again.
Elders are being put on the street,
again.
Which is nothing less than 368 code, penal code, elder abuse.
Yes, I mean, you're familiar with the eviction crisis that's going on.
It's horrible. I grew up here.
And
so you understand.
We've been
profoundly affected by this. I'm a housing organizer.
Right.
We don't have time to wait. And quite frankly,
that's right.
The landlords and the speculators have been hiding behind this shit way too long. And we can't wait. That's why we're here. I'm not here to waste my time. I'm not here for my health. We're here for our elders. We're here for our people. Okay? Now, you're a San Francisco born and raised guy. I am too. I care about this city. That's why I'm here.
That's why I'm here. That's why I'm in this office. But let me just say a couple of things.
What he's saying is the urgency of the situation warrants you to make a calendar appointment with us.
Right now.
Even though you may not be certain that what we're saying in the last meeting, we say with the urgency of the situation warrants your making a calendar and an appointment with us, given your even with your uncertainty.
I completely get that. What I'd like to do is let me tell you where I'm coming from. And first and foremost, let me also say anybody who's been evicted, anybody who has been a San Franciscan and is no longer able to call themselves a San Franciscan because of eviction or because of heartache, because of all of the things that have been happening, let me just say my heart goes out to you. This is sad. It's horrible that the crisis that we're going through right now as a city, it's really devastating. And as a San Franciscan, as a fellow San Franciscan, let me just say my heart goes out to you. Now, that being said, what I'd like to know, okay, because there are a lot of different things being mentioned here. You mentioned Sharon Wu's name a few times. She's not here to be able to speak on what she in fact said or said didn't say. Not to say that what you're saying is inaccurate, but anyone can be in a meeting and hear things differently. What she said or didn't say, I can't talk to because I wasn't in that meeting. Do you remember me in the meeting?
No.
But that being said, if you don't mind, that being said, I would like to set up a time. I would like to set up a time to have a discussion to see what there is additional, to see what evidence there is, to see what has occurred already. But what I'd like to be able to do is get a point of contact because what doesn't work well, in my opinion, is having 8 or 9 different points of contact with anything. And so
we can establish that.
Can I get a business card or some kind of contact information?
We'll provide you with contact information, and you already have the contact information. We'll give it to you again.
I don't have it.
You haven't provided it. We'll make that happen. You guys do communicate with one another. I mean, the DA's office has had it for over a year. But that being said, no, notwithstanding that, we'll give you that information now. Second point, let's set up the meeting now. Check your calendar, find out who's available.
Why don't you guys do, what day is it today, Tuesday?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Why don't we do the following Wednesday?
What day is that now?
The following Wednesday.
We'd like to do it on a Tuesday. Can we do three Tuesdays out? Because Tuesday is better for us. I mean, or Thursday. I mean, again, we can do a different date, but that's exactly the reason why I wanted to. That was exactly the discussion why I had asked to maybe have a back and forth on that, because I'm not throwing a date out there. You tell me that's not a date. I'm more than happy to do it on a Tuesday or Thursday, but I just have to check.
Okay, but you know right now that you have Wednesday the 13th, is that what they're saying?
No, it's not the 13th.
What is
it? Wednesday the 7th, most likely.
It's the 7th.
Yeah, see, this is why I like having everything on paper.
We'll do that. We'll confirm.
Wednesday the 7th.
Okay, so
if that's okay share with you guys. I think sooner is better. After what I, after everything, after the urgency of everything, I think sooner is better. So I wouldn't want to wait 3 weeks.
Okay.
I know that's probably something maybe you might want to do.
Let's confirm October 7th.
Yeah, let's do October 7th.
That's a Wednesday. I know Tuesdays are better, but can
Wednesday
be doable?
Okay, let's do the Wednesday.
But here's the thing. You're getting early. No, let's do Wednesday around 2.
Well, that might be is that okay? Will that work for you guys? Do
you prefer
4?
Let's
do Wednesday at 4.
And RICO can be applied even if the intention wasn't to break a law.
What's that?
RICO can be applied even if the intention wasn't to break a law.
RICO?
Racketeer, influence, corrupt organization.
Yeah.
But California has its own version of that also.
Right. So we're referring to the state statute.
So we got to make sure. Okay. So 4 p.m. I would like, so who are the people that are going to be the points of contact?
Anthony, you have your card or not?
I'll
give you my card. You can get me. Tony, do you have a card? If not, it's
no,
okay. We'll give you that.
Okay. Tony, give him your contact information. I'll
that's got all my info. Yeah.
And let me just be, what I would like is for the points of contact, wherever they may be.
Uh-huh.
I'm guessing you're one of them.
Uh-huh.
Your name's Tiny, right?
Uh-huh.
Tiny, so you'll be one of them. But
yeah.
I would like maybe one or two other points of contact so we can send out an email. Would you like to be a point of contact? Would you like to be
sure.
A point of contact? Whoever would like to be
Marty
a point of contact.
Claimant. Do you have email access, Marty?
Well, you know what? What we're going to do, we're not going to go that way.
Yeah.
What we're going to do is we're going to have Tiny as a point person, all the other point persons.
Yeah.
Can I get some business cards?
Yeah, I'll write that information down for you. Okay?
You have a business card?
No, I didn't bring it with me. So I'll write that information down for you. Okay?
Very well. You want to just throw it on the back?